year theme for this year, 2022, is manifesting and maintaining the presence of God. And what a thing. I think Elder Connor was saying, what a thing. I mean, in the 20-something years of this ministry, we've had some awesome things, building the family and different things. But I'm telling you, this thing has topped them all. And this is just the third week of the month, or the first month of the year. So I'm just excited to hear what God will say. But manifesting and maintaining the presence of God is what we're talking about for this year. What we're talking about for this month is shift, change, or pivot to reveal his glory. And Elder Johnson broke it down last week. You got to hear that recording of how she talked to us about what shift mean, what change mean, and what pivot mean. So we don't have no excuse. We don't have to be confused or anything. We know what it means. Sometimes it necessitates shift. Sometimes it necessitates change. And sometimes it necessitates a pivot. So let's make sure that we are hearing and adhering to the word of God. Let's move forward. Today, God has given me a message, and I want to talk to us because it just comes right on the back. It just picks right up where Elder Johnson left off on Tuesday night, and we got off the phone, off the call, getting to share with her that God had already been dealing with me along those lines. So when we're hearing from the same God, we have to get some of the same thing, I promise you. And so God is just continuing the conversation. God is always talking. We just have to tap in and hear what he's saying. But God is continuing the conversation. So we want to look at today, Revelation chapter 3, verses 14 through 20. Verses 14 through 20. For the sake of time, I might be reading kind of fast. So if you can't keep up with me, you can always go back and look at the tape, look at the video, hear the audio, whatever you need to do, or read the text on your own time. But Revelation 3, 14 through 20. And unto the angel of the church of the Laodiceans write, these things said the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of the creation of God. I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I would thou were cold or hot. So then, because thou art lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth. Because thou sayest, I am rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing, and knowest not that thou art wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked. I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire, that thou mayest be rich, and white raiment, that thou mayest be clothed, and that the shame of thy nakedness do not appear. And anoint thy eyes with eye salve, that thou mayest see. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous, therefore, and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come in to him and will sup with him and he with me. From this text we want to use, from these verses, a subject, lukewarm, the other side of being in the presence of God. Lukewarm. The other side of being in the presence of God. The other side of being in the presence of God. Now, please don't become religious and sanctimonious and say, oh, I already know about being lukewarm and I'm not lukewarm. Because I'm telling you, if God is calling our attention to this, I'm not saying you're not saved. I'm not saying you're not spirit-filled. But there's some areas in our lives that somewhere we have become lukewarm, and God is calling our attention that we may come up higher, that we may come from those places so we can manifest and maintain his presence. All right. Lukewarm means moderately warm, lacking conviction, It means half-hearted. It means showing little zeal or enthusiasm. Again, that's moderately warm, lacking conviction. Hear that? Half-hearted. Hear that also? Showing little zeal or enthusiasm. So God is saying to us, we need to look at it, because where have we become moderately warm? In what areas do we lack conviction? In what areas are we half-hearted, showing little zeal or enthusiasm? So God has always given this desire for man to live in his presence. Now we can readily see this as far back as the beginning when God put man in the garden. The Bible gives us to see that Adam was clothed with the presence of God. Genesis 3, 7 through 11 tells the story. It says, and the eyes of them both were open, and they knew that they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves aprons. Wait a minute. And they knew they were naked. Why was that brought out to our attention? Why was that put in the text? Was it talking about being physically naked? I think not. I think this was brought out because when Adam was created in the image of God and Eve was pulled up out of him, they were clothed in the glory of God. They were clothed in the presence of God. And at this particular time, when they disobeyed God, the Bible declares, and the eyes of them both were open, and then they knew they were naked. What naked has to do with? Naked has to do with they were stripped, or they was no longer in the place, in the presence of God, in the atmosphere, in the climate, in the dwelling place where God had placed them. Okay, I prove it to you. And they heard the voice of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. Watch this. And Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. Why is there a need to hide when you're in the presence, when you're one with God, when you're in communion with God? Why was there a need to hide? And the Lord God called unto Adam and said, Adam, where art thou? Oh, wait. Please don't get it twisted. He knew exactly where he was. God knows everything. He knew. He wasn't asking Adam because he was confused or he didn't know where he was. He was asking him, trying to call his attention to his place, to where he has shifted, to his lukewarmness, to where, oh God, I feel the Holy Ghost. He was trying to call his attention to where he had shifted, where he had pivoted from, and it wasn't where he needed to move. And verse 10 said, and I said, I heard thy voice. And I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid myself. And God is saying, this is what we're doing today. We know we're out of place with God. We know we're where we used to be. And sometimes when we hear his voice, we are still hiding ourselves. Woo! And he said, who told you you were naked? Where you got that from? You must be listening to another voice that was not my voice. Because I had already told you and gave you specific commandments and gave you specific instructions concerning who you are and what you have been called to do. So who told you you were naked? How did you get this information? Hast thou eaten of the tree whereof I commanded thee that thou shouldest eat? The only way you would have become naked, you must have disobeyed me. You must have shifted out of place. Because as long as you stayed there, you wouldn't have felt naked. As long as you stayed there, you wouldn't have been afraid. You wouldn't have had no need to hide. But apparently, there must have been a change from what was set up originally. Woo, God. So God is saying to us today, he said, what happened? Question, what happened to you and me who also started out in the garden or in the presence of God? Why is God calling our attention to Revelation 3? And why is God bringing our attention to the fact of being lukewarm? I think Genesis 3 and 11 give us a clue. God asked Adam, "Has thou eat of the tree whereof I commanded thee that I should not eat?" In other words, Adam, have you disobeyed what you heard in my presence because you thought you could do it your way? Ooh, I ain't getting no help now. How did you get here? You must have came to the conclusion, I don't have to do it like he said. I can do it some other way. I can do it my way. I can come up with my own, oh God, ideas and plans. But you know what Isaiah 55:8 says, for my thoughts are not your thoughts, and my ways are not your ways. But we proceed to attempt to do things our way, failing to understand the consequences thereof. Every time we obey God, anytime we disobey his commandment, it shifts us out of the presence. And God has said we don't have to continue to go in and out if we'll just obey him, because his presence is not a revolving door. Oh, Jesus. A revolving door takes you in and out. It takes you in. As a matter of fact, the revolving door keep going around and around. And God never meant for the people of God to be on a revolving door, in a revolving door. Adam and Eve was evicted from the garden or the presence of God as a result of them allowing themselves to be enticed by another voice that was not the voice of God. And sometimes we put all this on the devil, but I'm here to tell us it's the enemy, your greatest voice that's talking to you most of the time is your inner flesh, your inner you. Okay, Paul said, what I would do, the good I would do, I do it not, because I find another law in my members that's warred against my spirit. There's another voice in you that's always talking and trying to talk you out of the presence of God. Are y'all all right? Woo! Let's move on a little further. I'm already happy. We have allowed ourselves to get in a place of nakedness, and we have been stripped from the presence of God as a result of our blatant disobedience. And then we have the nerve to justify why we are choosing to be obedient. Man, when God told me that, I said, good God Almighty. God is saying, we justify our decision to be disobedient. Well, so-and-so. Well, just use for example, Pastor said, well, let's testify. Well, I don't want to testify. I don't feel led to testify. I don't have nothing to say. Good. But anything that we choose to use to justify being disobedient. God is saying to me, he said, disobedience to God, disobedience to those that have the rule over us, and disobedience to others, such as sisters and brothers in Christ, has been the catalyst that has caused us to find ourselves in lukewarm conditions. Do y'all hear me? It has been our disobedience that has shifted us into a place of being lukewarm. It has caused us to feel like it's okay to disobey. And God has said we got to understand that every word I say it with reason. I say it with purpose. I say it for your good. And anything you choose to disobey has the potential to shift you out of my presence. Are y'all all right? Adam and Eve thought it was okay to disobey God and eat of the tree. And it caused them to be shifted or to be put out of the presence of God. I'm gonna get on down to the text. In our text, John is in the presence of God. Revelation 1 and 10 said he was in the spirit on the Lord's day. My God, how many days can you say I was in the spirit on the Lord's day? Every day we should be saying, I'm in the spirit on the Lord's day. This is the day that the Lord has made, and I will rejoice and be glad, because I'm glad to be in the presence of God. And John received messages to give to the angels or the pastors of the seven churches in Asia Minor. was the church of the Laodiceans. And the message to the church, to this church, was different from other churches. How was it different, Apostle? I'll tell you. All the other churches, God had some good things to say about the church, and he had some things that needed some improvement. But when he got to the church of the Laodiceans, they did not receive a good report. God started out saying, I know your works. You may fool your family members or your co-workers. He said, well, I know how you live from day to day. I know how you live when you're not at church, when you're not around the other believers. I know your disobedience. I know what I tell you to do. I know, glory to God, how you blatantly disobey me. How you just say in your heart, I'm not going to do it. You show by your actions, I'm not going to be obedient. He said, I know your words. I am very acquainted with your behavior. Glory to God. Hallelujah. But then he said, you are neither cold nor hot. Lord have mercy. In other words, you are not in my presence, but you have not gone back in the world. You are straddling the fence and allowing yourself to live on the other side of my presence. Lord have mercy. You're not even cold. You're not even hot. Now, this David says something very interesting. This right here always puzzled me. He said, I would that you were cold or hot. That always puzzled me because I would think that God would say, I want you hot. He said, No. You have free will and you have free choice. And you don't have to be hot if you don't want to be hot. You have the right to be cold. My God, let's talk. But he said, the problem I got with it. You're not either hot or cold. My God, you're some combination of being cold and hot. Well, you lukewarm, and that's too much for me. I can deal with you being on fire. I can deal with you being cold as ice. I cannot deal with you being some combination of the both. Because that means you're trying to live in both worlds. You're trying to live in my presence and out my presence. You're trying to live. Sometimes I feel like being, and sometimes I don't give a care. He said, and I'm having issues with you living on the fence and being lukewarm. Actually, our state of being lukewarm, watch this, has derived from us revolving in and out of his presence to the point where we have become some combination of being both hot and cold. Are y'all all right? Some combination of the both. A little bit of cold and a little bit of hot. A little bit of God and a little bit of us. A little bit of the word and a little bit of what we want to do. Y'all ain't saying nothing to me. A little bit of obedience and a little bit of disobedience. And God said the combination thereof has shifted you to a lukewarm place. Are y'all all right? Woo! You don't even like something that's supposed to be cold being hot. Come on. I love sweet tea and I love Sprite. And when I drink them, me and my wife always kid each other. We'll take a sip of our drink and we'll say, oh, that's cold and that's cutting. That drink is so cold, you can feel it in your throat. It's so cold, it's supposed to be like that. It has a different feeling when it's supposed to be cold and it's ice cold, it's refreshing, it's good. And that coffee or that hot chocolate or that cappuccino, when it's supposed to be hot, it's a different feeling when that coffee is cold and it's supposed to be hot. And most of the time, when your coffee gets too warm, too lukewarm, you'll either heat it up or throw it out. Let's talk. Come on. You don't want no stuff. Okay. When your food get cold, you take it to the microwave. Because it's supposed to be hot. hot. Okay, but if the ice cream supposed to be cold, you don't want it hot, you want it cold. So God has said, if you don't like it, if you want cold things cold and you want hot things hot, what makes you think I'm going to accept what you give me just because you give it to me? I don't have to accept it. I'm calling your attention to it so you can change it, so you can shift, so you can move from that place. Are y'all all right? Woo, God, help me preach the word today. Hallelujah. Let's look at verse 16 in the text. He says, so then, because thou art lukewarm, let me tell you what I'm going to have to do. And you're neither cold nor hot. He said again, I'm good with you being cold. I'm good with you being hot. But because you are lukewarm, I will spew thee out of my mouth. That is a specific consequence for us allowing ourselves to fall into a half-hearted, moderately warm place where we lack convictions for being naked and absent from his presence. God is saying, I have to deal with you expressly and directly because I cannot allow you to live on the other side of my presence. Because life is in my presence. Joy is in my presence. Peace is in my presence. And we still want those things, but we still want to remain lukewarm. God said, you can't have it like that, baby. It's going to be my way or no way. You ain't going to twist my arm and manipulate me and try to get me to do it your way. If you want the blessings of God and to live with me and to reign with me in this hour, in this season, if you want the blessings of God, if you want the power of God, if you want the glory of God, you're going to have to live in my presence. You can't be in this lukewarm place. So God used strong and direct words to convey his sentiment. He said, I'm going to cast you up and out of my presence because you don't reverence and cherish it to the place you used to. You have come to the place where you have caused me to desire to vomit. I said, good God Almighty. God has said, you have come to the place where you make me sick. You make me nauseous. Oh, y'all ain't saying that. Yeah. God has blessed us. God has given us what we asked for. He's given us favor. He's given us houses. He's given us cars. He's given us jobs. He's given us promotion. He's given us increase. He's given us children. He's given us family, restoration, relationship with restoration. He's given us so much. And he said, yet we still want to live in our lukewarm places. He said, oh, no, that's making me sick. That's making me uncomfortable. And I got to spew you out. I got to upchuck you because you are not where I need you to be, and I continue to give you warning, and you won't move. Oh, Jesus, are y'all all right? I'm not saying, please get this, it's in my nose. I'm not saying you're no longer saved. I'm not saying you're not a believer. I'm not saying you're not spirit-filled, and I'm not saying you're not a tongue speaker. What I'm saying is, we're not abiding in the raw presence of God because we go in and out as a result of our disobedience. Whatever area that God is still dealing with you about and you refuse to comply, come on, whatever it is, giving, being obedient, praying, seeking my face, walking in your calling, whatever it is, we all got places where God is still has not been able to get us to shift, and we're lukewarm and feel like it's okay. Are y'all all right? There's much danger falling and remaining in this place. Let's look a little bit deeper at this place God has called our attention to. because God don't want us to remain in this place. All right. There's some things God said to me as it relates to being lukewarm. The first thing he said to me, he said, our state of lukewarm has caused us to lose our reverential fear of God. It used to be a time, or when we first got saved, we reverenced God. We reverenced God all day long. We didn't want to hurt nobody. We didn't want to get mad with nobody. We didn't want to argue with nobody. Oh, y'all ain't talking now. We didn't want to have nothing against nobody. We love everybody, even the people that did us wrong, even the people that hated us. We still loved them. We wanted to love them. We thought that it was our reason of service to love them. We obeyed God. If God said fast, we fast. If God said pray, we pray. If God said sing, we sing. If God said obey the pastor, we obey the pastor. We did whatever we felt like it was necessary to do because we feared God and we had reverential fear for him. Fear don't mean being scared of him. Fear means I honor him and respect him. Are y'all all right? Malachi 1 and 6 says a son honor his father and a servant his master. If then I be a father, where is my honor? What I'm saying, what happened to my honor? What happened to that respect? What happened to that reverential fear you had for me? And if I be a master, where is my fear? Said the Lord of hosts, O priest that despise my name. And you say, wherewith have we despised thy name? God has said we despise his name when we okay with being disobedient and justifying our disobedience. Are y'all okay? I'm going to keep teaching, so I hope you hold on to your belt. He said, we lost our reverential fear. We lost the honor for God. Our country, our government was built on God, on the things of God, on the principles of the word. We've lost our reverential fear. And that same spirit has crept into the body of Christ. And we don't have the reverential fear we used to have. No, we don't honor God. No. We don't honor God. No. I said, no, we don't honor him. The second thing he said to me, we fail to apply what we receive in his presence to our everyday life. We come to church, we hear the word, we come on the Zoom, we hear the word, we say we pray, we say we get in his presence, but we fail to apply what we receive in his presence to our everyday life. Watch this. Therefore, we forfeit the opportunity to see the manifestation of his presence on an ongoing basis. We forfeit the opportunity to see God move and interact in our situation because we don't apply what he said in his presence. If he said to give more, if he said to have faith, if he said to trust him in his presence, we come right back out and start worrying. We come back out and start trying to figure it out on paper. We come back out and start and won't increase our giving. We come back out and won't be obedient to what God says. This weakens our faith and causes us to cast away our confidence in God. Are y'all all right? Hebrews tell us, I think it's 10:35, cast not away therefore your confidence, which has great recompense of reward, for you have need of patience, that after you've done the will of God, you shall receive the promise. Sometimes we don't see it because we don't do it. It's not because God didn't say it. It's because we didn't walk it out. We didn't apply it. We didn't walk by faith. We didn't add mixed faith with faith. So now we don't see it. And your enemy or your spirit or your flesh want you to doubt that God was able to do it. It wasn't that God couldn't do it. It's because you didn't do it. Oh, Jesus. Oh, Lord. God always gives us something to do before we see what he's saying. Okay? Read the Bible. I'll put the New Testament. Take up your bed and walk. Go dip in the pool of Siloam. Go show yourself to the priest. I always give you something to do. I always give you something to apply. I always give you something to walk out before you see manifestation. Woo! Hebrews 4 and 2 said, for unto us was the gospel preached, as well as unto them. But the word preached did not profit, not being mixed with faith in them that heard it. You heard the same word I heard. You heard the same expressions I got. You got the same revelation God gave me, but you didn't see it because you didn't apply it. And now you want to say it don't work. The devil is a lie. God's word always works if you never have to work it. Oh, y'all know. Okay. I'm going to calm down. The third thing you say, we quench the thirst that arises in our spirit for more of God and his presence. Watch this. By allowing ourselves to become intoxicated with worldly pleasures. I said, good God Almighty. I said again, we quench the thirst that arises in our spirit for more of God and his presence by allowing ourselves to become intoxicated with worldly pleasures. 2 Timothy 3 and 4 said, they will be lovers of pleasure. Y'all won't talk to this man of God more than lovers of God. And God said, that's why we lukewarm, because we love pleasure more than we love God. We're okay with watching movies and being on Facebook and watching football games. Y'all ain't saying nothing. And watching sitcoms and reality shows. And we're more okay with worldly pleasures and more time than we would in the spirit in his presence. Are y'all all right? I'm not saying that there's nothing wrong with it. I'm not saying absolutely nothing wrong with it. But I am saying it should not be more than we will win in the spirit with God. And now we wonder why we don't see manifestation, why we don't see all God said, why we don't see the signs, the miracles, and the wonders. We've seen some, but God said, that's so much more. That's so much more I want to do. But I need you to spend time in my presence and shift from being lukewarm. Oh, God have mercy. The last thing he said, and maybe this would be a good place to close, I don't know. We fail to seek him while he's near. I said, God, what you saying? He said, we leave his presence. And at some point later, we attempt to find him, not understanding that he's not in the same place we last encountered. God, help me today. I said again, we leave his presence. Then at some point where we need him again, we attempt to find him, not understanding that he's not in the same place we last encountered him. So we come back thinking he was standing there waiting on us to return. Okay? But God said, I'm always moving. I'm always shifting. That's why the Bible said, in him I live, and in him I what? Move. Because God is always moving. So if we're going to stay with him, we got to be moving in and with him. But God don't stop and wait on you because you left his presence. So we fail to seek him while he is near. And then when we want him, he seems so far away. Y'all ain't talking to me now. When we get in serious places, oh, we can't hear from God. I can't see my prayer not going out the road. What's wrong with you? Had you stayed in the presence, he was right there. In his presence is the fullness of joy and his right hand. How you gonna get to the right hand unless you're near? Oh, God, you can't walk away and get what's in the right hand. Oh, have mercy. We won't seek him while he's near. And then we get discouraged and despondent and we feel like giving up and leaving the church. Y'all ain't saying nothing because we didn't seek him while he may be found and we didn't call upon him while he was near. We walked away. I'm good. I got my job. I got my house. I got my promotion. I got my children. I got my car. I got my increase. Oh, y'all ain't saying nothing. I got my whatever I was seeking God for. I got it. I'm good. So we walked away from his presence. And then we tried to come back and find him, and he wasn't there. Now I got to try to find out where he is. But he said, no, stay in my presence. Seek me while I may be found. Call up on me while I'm near. Stay in my presence. Don't revolve in and out. Walk with me. Eat up, walk with God. Y'all ain't talking to me. He didn't walk before him. He didn't walk behind him. He wasn't 2 blocks over. He was walking in sync with God. For we walk by faith. We walk by faith, we walk with God. Okay. The presence of God is the place to be. And if we're not careful, watch this, we will forfeit the prepared place he has for us and settle to live in a lukewarm place. Did y'all hear me? There's a place prepared for you. I go to prepare a place for you. John 14 is not a funeral scripture. I don't care how many more people preach it at the funeral. It's for you living down here. I went away. I left. And I prepared a place in my presence for you. And where I am, you can be also. I want you there. I prepared it for you. It's already ready. But you have to choose to be in that place. Ooh. Or you can settle to live in a lukewarm place. This is not God's best for you. Actually, it is the other side of God's presence. And what, over there, there's no protection, no provision. There's only dread and torment. Okay. Okay, you want some scripture? When Adam and Eve was put out of the garden, they had a toll. Okay. They had to sweat. Everything was a struggle. Yeah, everything came hard. Everything came with torment. Y'all ain't saying that. I'm telling you, God has a place for you that there's no struggle. The blessing of the Lord make it rich and add no sorrow or pain for toil. The Amplified says, but when we stay in these lukewarm places, we stay in struggle, we stay in discouragement, we stay in fear, we stay in anxiety. Y'all ain't saying that. We stay, glory to God, in places that was never created for us. So God is saying to us that I'm warning you before I cast you out. But you cannot remain in the place of being lukewarm. You must hear and adhere to my message to you and make the necessary changes to move from this place. I'm sending my word. I'm giving you a thing. I put it in your leader and his wife, Ellen Johnson. I put it in there for you to understand what I'm saying, where I'm calling you to. You cannot remain in lukewarm places. Do we hear God? I'm talking about Apostle Johnson all the way to the back door, to the rats and the roaches. We can't stay in these places, wherever it is, that we become a lukewarm, we become half-hearted, we become showing no kind of zeal or enthusiasm, and we're okay with blatant disobedience. We must shift. We must change. So God told the church, Laodicea, since you're not hot or cold, I'm going to have to deal with you. I'd much rather you just go and be cold. Stop playing with me. God told me that. I wrote it in my notes. God said, we treat the presence of God like a toy a child play with. I said, God, what are you saying? He said, a child picks up the toy and play with it for a minute. and 5 minutes later, throw the toy down. See, love, I can't get no amen. I can't get no thumbs up. What are you saying? We treat the presence of God like a toy. We play with it for a season. We entertain it for a season. We have these spares where I want more of God. I want him for your glory. I'll do anything. I'll cross the highest bidder. I'll travel the ocean. I'll go wherever you said go. I'll do your will. I'll sing for you. I'll preach for you. I'll pray for you. I'll witness for you. Just temporarily. Most of the time, it's because we want something. Y'all don't want to talk to this man of God, but I'm going to talk to you. We want something, so we get in his presence because we want something. God never told us to come seeking him for things. He said, seek me for me. Y'all ain't said, okay. He never said, seek my hand. He said, seek my face. My face has nothing to do with my gifts. God said we want the gifts, but we don't want the glory. Okay. And once we get the gift, we ain't starting to grow glory anymore. The glory, it'll be okay until I want some things again. But he said, seek ye first the kingdom, and the things will be added. You never have to seek things if you seek the giver. If you ever get him, he'll give you what's in his hand. Are y'all okay? So God is saying, it's caused us to be lukewarm because we use his presence for a toy and we just go in and out as we need stuff and as we want stuff and then we throw it down to sometime. That equates to a form of godliness and leaves us denying the power. Are y'all okay? God said it equates to us being lukewarm, a little bit of hot, and a little bit of cold. And God said, in this season, this year, I'm calling you out of those places, lest I spew you out. Don't tell me you can't get banned from his presence. David said, cast me not away from thy presence, and take not your spirit from me. Don't tell me you can't. Oh, okay. What God said to me, you can remain in his omnipresence, but you won't be in his divine presence. What God told me, everybody is in his omnipresence. Y'all won't talk to me, but everybody is not in his divine presence. And God is saying, the place I call for you to live is in my divine presence, not just my omnipresence. God is everywhere at the same time. But I got better for you. You can live in my divine presence. There's a deeper place. There's a closer place. There's a place prepared for you in my divine presence. But you can't live there and be disobedient. Stop justifying what you choose not to do. I'm not going to help the building fund because I don't see nothing happen. God said, I can't bless you. I have asked you to give to this. I have asked you to do this. I've asked you to let go of this. I've asked you to take on this, put off that. Whatever God has told us to do, God is saying we can't remain lukewarm if we want to manifest and maintain his presence. My time is up. My time is up. Maybe you were blessed by the word. I hope you was. It stepped on my toe, and so I just passed the pain home. God bless you. I pray you'll come back Tuesday night and hear the conclusion of this matter, because there's more God wants to say to us about living in his presence and not living on the other side of his presence in a place called lukewarm. We don't want God to throw us out. We don't want God to spew us out. It's a lonely, dry, dead, dreadful place to be out of the presence of God. And God is saying, I'm calling your attention so you can come up hither, so you can shift, so you can change. You don't have to stay there. I love you too much to leave you there. So I'm sending my word to meet you where you are, so you can come up out of that place. Be encouraged. Thank God for his word. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word today. Thank you. I pray this word fell on some good ground. Somebody would take this word and run with it. Somebody say, I see myself in your word. Thank you for showing me. And God, help me to come up from this place in whatever area, in all areas, across the board. Help me to get back on fire. I don't even want to be cold. And I definitely don't want to be lukewarm. I want to be hot, fervent in your spirit. I want to be all you call me to be. I want to dwell in your presence. I don't want to be in that revolving door, going in and out. Sometimes I have your presence. Sometimes I do it my way. Sometimes I obey. Sometimes I disobey you. And I justify and feel comfortable being disobedient. But God, help me. Help us to come up out of these places and be all you called us to be. It's in Jesus' name we do pray. All God people said, amen. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you.